That's really great. It's nice to see some of these assets bouncing back. I mean, some of these real estate properties really have been incredibly successful over the year, and I look forward to the Security Token Market 2020 report to see how they've performed the last full 12 months. You know, that's the real deal to kind of evaluate the one-year profile. So looking forward to that later. And as we move into the final month of the year here, we'll go back and, of course, review our predictions from January and calculate the total market growth. But for now, we've got a main topic to get to, compliance for STOs. Now that is sexy stuff.
So compliance might not be totally sexy, Herwig, but it really should be where your attention is. Compliance is the difference of having to pay huge fines to regulators, having a tainted brand from bad press, or needing to return all of the money you just raised from STO investors.
I mean, that's absolutely right. I've seen it all from ICOs to STOs, and as many of you listeners on the show already know, I started a compliance technology called Invest Ready before starting Security Token Group, so I consider myself somewhat familiar with compliance, specifically for fundraising in the US. And our customers are equity crowdfunding portals and issuers doing digital fundraisers. So I do think I know this stuff pretty well, but please, folks, do know I am not an attorney.
Despite the fact that many people often seem to think you are.
And then every day I love saying that to them that I am not. Personally, I'm not a fan actually of the role that attorneys do need to play, but it's such an important one. And I do love many actual securities attorneys, and I'm always happy to recommend one to you. You absolutely need to use a securities attorney if you're doing an STO. There are simply no ifs, ands, or buts about it.
Yes, and as you said, they are the key to making sure that you don't ruin your security token offering. So how did you want to break down compliance for STOs, man? I mean, should we walk through an offering maybe?
Actually, before we do that, let's remind our listeners that there are over 130 different financial jurisdictions all around the world. And guess what? Each one of them has their very own set of securities laws and compliance requirements. The biggest challenge for issuers and one of the most magnificent things I think about security tokens is the ability to pre-program compliance and digitally enforce it using blockchain and software. This is why the future is global, not local, and that is, I believe, where we're going to see a major increase in global financing as a result of security token technology. So when it comes to doing an STO, an issuer needs to be aware that the compliance requirements exist in their own country as well as the world. And in most scenarios, either the local jurisdiction doesn't care about foreign investors as much, like in the United States, they only care about taxes and fraud. And then other countries where international investors have a much more difficult time, such as in Singapore, where many security token exchanges aren't even open to US investors currently. So, you know, lots of compliance things you need to be considering.
All right. So step one, you got to talk to your attorney about your local laws around fundraising and also how the regulators and the law treats foreign investors as well if you plan to accept them for your offering, right?
Yes, exactly. And so step two is that this is the step that most people forget. You need to know the rules for the outside jurisdictions as well. So for some of the bigger issuers and fundraisers, some of them invest in legal firms in every major region they are considering accepting investments. Other solutions include leveraging existing providers like issuance and crowdfunding platforms that have already supported specific countries. And also even my company Invest Ready is a solution that currently covers 50 jurisdictions to help you make sure the investor you accept from that region is allowed to invest.
So all in all, to summarize what you're saying is that for a security token offering, you need to consider regulations of each jurisdiction that you want to support, which can be a fairly big investment in both time and setup. But alternatively, some security token platforms and solutions can help you navigate this much more easily, and that enforcing and managing this can be done through software and blockchain instead of doing it fully manually, right?
Yep. iComply, for example, is an entirely dedicated compliance solution you can build out based on the jurisdictions you are supporting and from where you're fundraising from. But now let's get into the actual offering example like you mentioned, Kyle. Your local jurisdiction is going to have some kind of fundraising framework for you to use for your STO. That fact that blockchain tokens are involved shouldn't change much of what is done from a compliance standpoint when it comes to following securities laws. If anything, as you said, Kyle, it makes it easier to follow. What is important is recognize how much you want to raise, whether you raise it privately or publicly, and also who you want to raise it from.
So you said there are three things to determine: the size of the offering, the method of the fundraising, and the type of investor that you want to support. So then let's make up an offering example. Let's say we're here in the US, we want to raise $2 million for a real estate project privately from anyone in the world. Where would we go from there?
Well, in this case, you could use regulation crowdfunding exemption here in the U.S., which now soon will support up to $5 million in funding rounds, right? And allows you to raise from anyone in the U.S. as well as outside of it. So they have specific rules and compliance requirements for issuers that use RegCF, and you need to find a sponsor. This would be called a licensed funding portal or a broker-dealer in the U.S. And the attorneys and sponsor would explain to you the requirements, some of which may even differ in stringency based on the sponsor itself in order to keep their own quality of deals for their investor base high, right?
All right. So you're saying based on those three factors, you'd likely need to leverage a different part of the fundraising framework in your jurisdiction. Like if you wanted to do $10 million instead of $2 million, what changes?
Well, now RegCF would no longer be sufficient, right? And your options could either be RegCF to raise up to $5 million there and then raise another $5 million from private investors using Reg D. There you get your $10 million. Or you could try to just use Reg A Plus to raise the full $10 million instead, another exemption. This one requires SEC approval. Or you could always go public, but that likely doesn't make sense for an offering of that size. And listeners, if you are hearing all of these exemption buzzwords for the first time, then I highly recommend you take 10 minutes to listen to episode 53 of the show where we cover all of this. You can find the clip on YouTube and you'll get the rundown.
Yeah, so you know that we do the main topics here after we do all of the news, and we publish all those main topics separately. 53 is a great one to cover all these fundraising exemptions. You got to check that one out. It's a core of security tokens and fundraising here in the States. But also, I get your point, Herwig. I don't think that we need to get dragged into a bunch of different examples, but simply based on whether you want to raise it privately or publicly, how much you want to raise, and who you raise it from will all affect the fundraising exemptions that are available to you based on the financial framework in your home jurisdiction, which may mean more compliance requirements or specific limitations, like only raising a certain amount or being limited to a certain number of people.
Yeah, that is correct. And that sets the stage for compliance moving forward, too. There will be requirements from a primary offering perspective, right? That's the fundraise itself. And also from a secondary trading perspective as well. We're talking about lockup periods, who it can trade to, the reporting requirements. All these things are determined by the fundraising exemption and the framework.
What about KYC? I mean, we mentioned it earlier in the episode, and it's obviously very, very important.
It's absolutely, definitely very important, Kyle. It's almost a universal requirement. So KYC stands for Know Your Customer, and it's almost always paired with AML, which stands for Anti-Money Laundering. So when you take money from an investor you don't know, you want to, and typically are legally required to do a KYC AML check. And of course, many software solutions and service providers have dedicated tools to make this easy to do. But of course, these rules and requirements change based on each jurisdiction as well. So always keep that in mind. Also, these checks don't necessarily need to be one-offs, as people can and do change, right? And so these checks may be run repeatedly on people, depending on how safe you want to be as a platform, like a secondary exchange or a bank or the issuers themselves.
So tying it all together, we're really talking about the fundraising framework determining how much you can raise and from who, and then the financial regulations that need to be followed from each jurisdiction that you want to support. But the powerful technology of security tokens does enable us to enforce and follow these rules much easier via programmatic platforms. And of course, you need a great securities attorney, or most likely several, to navigate this whole thing.
Yeah, and from a compliance 101 perspective, that is all absolutely right. And issuance platforms and attorneys are designed to make this easier for you, but keep in mind that there are come with operational changes that you need to consider too, like needing to report financial performance to investors if you go public or use Rule 144 in the financial framework in the US. All these things need to be considered and evaluated as an issuer when you are preparing to do a security token offering. And that's all about what I have to say on compliance, Kyle.
So while everybody likes to focus on the fundraising and all the exciting parts of a security token offering and the blockchain and all these great buzzwords, the sexy stuff, this is the things that you need to focus on to do it right. I think people are going to appreciate this, Herwig, despite the fact that, again, it's a little bit more of a nuts and bolts kind of a thing. It's just these are rules that you have to follow. And I mean, we all saw what happened to even some of the most high profile ICOs that didn't follow the rules. The same will be with security token offerings that don't follow the rules. And again, the rules are pretty clear. It's not that difficult to follow them. You just got to find a good attorney to work with. And that sounds like a wrap for this episode, folks. So remember, submit any news or articles to stomarket.com/news. Reach out to us directly on Twitter, LinkedIn, wherever is convenient for you, Instagram, we're everywhere. And keep the conversation going. Thanks again, everyone, for listening.
Yeah, and if you need help considering all this stuff, shoot us a message at Security Token Advisors. Meanwhile, thank you for taking the time to listen, and I look forward to talking to all of you again next week.